Poland. You have probably heard of it. It is famous for state-founded homophobia lately, and not so much for Polish hospitals. Or was it hospitality? Well, that's an easy mistake to make, as all three of them are only sort of real as we speak. Anyways, Poland is a country with people in it, and believe it or not, Poles eat food. If you have ever been to Poland, you probably know some of the dishes. But believe you me, there is a lot more to unpack. And what is there to unpack, I have categorized into 5 tiers. If something you know or love is not on the list, do not panic. I just tried to leave out the things that are widely present in other cultures and do not have at least a Polish spin put to it. So things like naleśniki, which are just crepes, or kompot, present everywhere in the Eastern Bloc countries, are not included in the list. I will now attempt to entertain you with quirky food facts. Please do not resist. If you know most of the dishes in this tier, you have probably visited Poland once or twice, or at least have heard someone speaking about the country. If you don't know them, you should get at it. All things listed in this episode are really worth trying. To start off, we have the basic couple of soups that are made by making the chicken soup first, and then spicing it up a bit. Since Poles tend to be less affluent than other Europeans, this is a common end-of-the-month sort of meal that lets you survive until you receive your next paycheck. Most popular entries are the tomato soup, the ominous vegetable soup, and I don't want to insult your intelligence by getting into details about how to make those. There is one that is a bit more interesting though, barszcz. Polish barszcz, even though it is commonly referred to as the Ukrainian barszcz, is different from the one most commonly prepared in Ukraine. There cannot be a borscht in the East without a fair share of chopped cabbage in it. If you try to put cabbage in the Polish-Ukrainian barszcz, though, you would be chopped instead. Pierogi are a Polish spin on the omnipresent dumpling that Poles love to take way more credit than it's due. It is almost the same kind of dough you would use for the Italian pasta, but when you form it into this very recognizable shape and put whatever you find fitting inside of it before boiling, it makes you feel like an Italian chef, but suddenly alcoholic, depressed and overworked. Of course, similar concepts can be found in almost all cultures around the globe. But it was the Chinese that found this idea first, so Poles only naturally eat it with anything labeled edible. You will find them with pre-fried minced meat, spinach, cabbage and mushrooms, and most popularly, potatoes, onion and quark. That is the so-called pierogi ruskie variant. Rusek is a derogatory term that describes Russian. Ruski is an adjective made from that word. They are not at all popular in Russia, though, and are commonly thought of as a Ukrainian dish there. Well, because it is. The legend has it that Saint Jacek Odrowąż, after returning from his mission in Kyiv, came back to Poland with the recipe. I am tempted to believe it, because with some fried onion on top, the taste of pierogi ruskie is downright divine. Bigus. It is commonly translated as the hunter's stew. It is made, or should I say created, by slow cooking chopped cabbage with meat and mushrooms. The process takes about 3 to 5 days, which in turn makes bigus a more stable currency than the Polish złoty, especially for the gypsies that are well known to use it as such. It is delicious, and in fact so important that it has been famously romanticized in the most quintessential Polish piece of literature, Pan Tadeusz, written by Adam Mickiewicz on Exile. I will give you what Poles thought of the bigus roughly 200 years ago.
The biggest is being cooked.
No words can tell the wonder of its color, tastes, and smell. Me words and rhymes are jingling sounds whose sense no city stomach really comprehends. For Lithuanian food and song, you ought to have good health and country life and sport. But bigus in without such sauce is good, of vegetables curiously brewed, the basis of it is sliced sauerkraut, which, as they say, just walks into the mouth. Enclosed within a cauldron, its moist breast lies on the choicest meat in slices pressed. There it parboiled till the heat throws out the living juices from the cauldron spout. T'was ready now. With thrice repeated yell, the huntsmen armed with spoons attacked the stew. The copper roared and forth the vapor flew. The bigus disappeared like camphor oil. Only the pots were left to seethe and boil. Bigus is also widely acclaimed for its calming capabilities. After an outrage of a Janusz, stereotypical Polish boomer, he will say something along the lines of,
Helena! Gotuj bigos na uspokojenie, ja tego dłużej nie wytrzymię!
Which translates roughly to Halina, stereotypical Polish boomerette,
go make the calming bigos, I cannot take it anymore!
It is never known what causes Janusz to be in such a despair. His neighbor probably bought himself a brand new Passat from 2007. But really, we can never be sure. You look at Schabowy and think, wait, that's just schnitzel. And you would be sort of right to think that. The deep Schabowy lore looks roughly like this. When the Austro-Hungarian Empire fought the war in Vienna, they found a somewhat niche dish.
Cotoletta alla milanese.
General Radetzky liked it so much he wanted to eat it once he returns home as well. And so they started to make the Wiener Schnitzel. Poland, having been partitioned by Austria 90-something years prior to that fact, was bound to be influenced by the Austrian culture. What Poles didn't have, though, is lamb. I guess it wasn't popular. But what they did have is pork. And classic Polish schabowy is made out of a pork loin, sometimes with a bone still inside of it. Which, granted, makes the meat more delicate, but so much less enjoyable to eat. Potato pancakes are grated raw potatoes and onions that are held together with eggs and flour. You fry them, and there you have it. It requires an endurance of a Slavic woman to prepare, though, especially in larger quantities. For all of you Westerners coming here to eat, I suggest you buy them pre-made, and for some of you preheated. You can enjoy them with a pinch of salt or sometimes sugar, dip them in refreshing sour cream, and you are going to be full in no time. Yet you will become insatiable. They're simply too good. You can eat them in various restaurants in two most dominant forms. Placek po zbójnicku and placek po węgiersku. But they are the same dish. The same goulash served under a large potato pancake dish. But it doesn't stop there. No Hungarian has ever heard of it, and no mountain bandit would have been able to afford such a succulent meal to be the main course of his diet. You might be seeing a pattern here with pierogi ruskie and Hungarian potato pancakes, and it is no coincidence that Poles named their dishes as if they came from abroad. You see, Poland, or rather Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, objectively the best country to have ever existed, by the way, was so great, it did Venezuela before it was cool. It grew so rich off of grain trade, which was sort of like the fossil fuels of the past, it didn't bother producing necessary goods domestically. In fact, people were shunned as closed-minded for wanting Polish goods over imported ones. That is how I believe the trend of calling Polish dishes as if they were foreign started. But I might be full of shit, so there's that. Anyways, the scheme worked for a while, but oh no, here comes Columbus with his brand new land and potatoes. You see, the deal with potatoes is that you boil them and they are ready to eat. On the other hand, to make wheat into something edible, you first need to collect it, which is already tiresome, and that is only the beginning of its way. Next, you need the mill to make flour and yada yada yada. So you see, when bad times for grain export hit, you have no money. No money means no imported goods, and when you rely solely on them, even in the area as important as, you know, defending your borders, it spells trouble. So yes, I think that potatoes are the literal antichrist for destroying Jesus' beloved country that was the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth. The potato pancakes are great, though. Try them. Italians have pizza. And Poles had socialism. In the 70s, the first secretary, Edward Gierek, bought a license to produce baguettes in Poland. Very quickly, Poles added everything else they had to eat at the time, so onions, cheese and mushrooms that they found in the forest, I presume, out of desperation. Zapiekanka was the street food in Poland for a long while, partially because the state had not given the permission for any other street food to exist. The premise is simple. You have a baguette, you cut it in half horizontally, and you cover the top half with previously mentioned cheese, mushrooms, and sometimes onion. For it not to be too dry, you can make a fancy snake shape with ketchup and or garlic sauce, and bam! There you have it. You might add ham or chicken or whatever topping you desire, really, now that Poland is no longer a socialist shit. Now that Poland is less socialist. You have probably heard of the so-called Polish sausage. And apart from sounding like a B-class porno film from the 80s, it has just as much to do with the subject matter. There is an actual metric fuckton of sausage varieties present in the Polish stores. If you came to any butchers in Poland and asked for Polish sausage, he would look at you confused as all the sausages he has to offer are made in Poland. The closest thing to what you know as the Polish sausage would be, I think, kiełbasa śląska, so Silesian. The lowest of the low, really. I guess there is one called zwyczajna, meaning traditional or normal, but it looks nothing like the Polish sausage commonly served in the West. And there is so much variety, like, just hear me out, there is Żywiecka, Krakowska, Krucha Zmleczkowa, Toruńska, Podwawelska, Biała, Myśliwska, and then an entire subgroup of kabanosy that are like the Polish beef jerky, except actually tasty. Polish sausages are so good that when I once gave a piece of a real pork-filled Podwawelska to a Jew, after tasting it, he said, with tears in his eyes, that this is not just food. It is an experience worth being a bad Jew. Try some of them, and you will never want the substitute that is whatever vendors mean in the West with the Polish sausage. Every culture has their own cheesecake. Polish sernik is characterized by its weight and fat content. The logic behind it is that the more whey it puts into your intestines, the more you can feel your grandma's love. Polish cheesecake is based on quark, to be exact, which is the main reason why it is so heavy. Well-made Cernik, while weighing about as much as a fully loaded cargo ship, still manages to be fluffy and delightfully squishy, making it a joy to eat. Just remember, peach is always a better option than raisins. Ptasie Mleczko translates literally to bird's milk. Normally, the name is associated with the fact that it is supposed to be light, soft and fluffy. Yet here you are thinking about bird's cum, you lewd little piggy. Chocolate-coated, milky marshmallow cubes. Nice, but they used to taste better. If I were you, I would aim for the ones coated in the milk chocolate, not the vanilla ones everybody gets, I presume purely out of nostalgia. They're pretty similar to the so-called
Negersoen
that are well acclaimed in Denmark. Ptasie Mleczko, though, has gelatin in it, which makes it more stiff than fluffy. Those chocolate-coated marshmallow treats, as they are called in English, so boringly, are also present in Poland under the name Ciepłolody, warm ice cream. Fun fact about Ptasie Mleczko is that it has 441 kilocalories in 100 gram portion, or about 5 cubes. That means that it has 4,410 kilocalories per kilogram, which translates to about 18.45 megajoules per kilogram. Coal, which currently powers about 80% of Poland, has roughly 23 megajoules of energy per kilogram. Do with this information what you will. Gingerbreads. Famously, gingerbreads from Toruń cure cancer. Well, no they don't, but high-quality gingerbread is the only good thing about that town. They tend to be soft on the inside, crunchy on the outside, and have a fruity filling. If you ever end up visiting Toruń, you absolutely need to try some of them before you get mugged. Krówki, that are translated literally as cowlets, they are milky fudge candy that melts in your mouth and tries to pull not only your teeth, but an entirety of your jawline from you, or can be kinda crunchy and break into chunks before dissolving in your mouth. Clueless Polaks tried to export them to India once, but forgot to change the name. And nobody wanted to eat them, since, well, you cannot eat cows in India. Stupid Poles. Oh. Yeah, that. Do not be intimidated by the name. Be intimidated by the content. Śliwka na Łęczowska. A chocolate-coated plum. I personally like it. Foreigners seem to like it as well, but there are just better sweets to eat in Poland. It is the most passive-aggressive sweet you can give to a Pole if you are not at least two generations older than him, though. Grandmas will give it to their grandchildren, but they get a pass because that's the best sweet they know from their youth. And you will receive, you will enjoy, and you will be thankful for your chocolate plum when given by your granny. That concludes tier 1 of the Polish food iceberg. If you would like to see more of these types of video, this is a series that I've planned to release on a semi-regular basis. You know how it is, I like to keep my audience, consisted of three of my friends and my mom, on their toes. So the next video might be out tomorrow, in 2 weeks, or never. You never know, so stay tuned. If you did enjoy this video, please remember to share it with your friends and family so we can spread the laughs all across the globe. See you guys next time. All of the food art that is present in the video has been brought to you by a lovely young artist going by the name Vivernaven. All her contact information is present in the description down below.